This is Fox 31 Now.
Good morning. Thank you so much for tuning into Fox 31 Now. I'm Alex Rose. COVID trends across the board, whether you're talking about cases, positivity rates, or hospitalizations, they're all finally starting to trend back down in Colorado ahead of the summer season. CDPHE is providing the latest information on COVID-19 in our state. Let's go ahead and listen in.
Good morning. At this time, our data sources are starting to show a decline in cases. This slide shows the number of cases that have been reported to public health. In red is the 7-day moving average number of cases. In gray are the daily reported case counts. And over to the right, you can see those counts are starting to decline. Currently, we're averaging about 1,800 cases reported per day. And our peak was on June 9th. It was a far lower peak than we saw during our other peaks during the start of the year and in the fall. Could you go to the next slide, please? Here's a zoomed in version of that same information with a clear increase in cases through April and May, and now a decline in cases since June 9th. Next slide, please. Our percent positivity has plateaued and started to decline in recent days as well. Our current 7-day average positivity is just over 11% and is trending downward. Next slide, please. In terms of hospitalizations, they have also decreased slightly. Last week at this time, we had 323 people who were hospitalized. And this week, we're at 304 people who are currently hospitalized. And we expect hospitalization numbers to come down a bit more slowly than case counts. And of course, we'll continue to monitor that as well as our other data sources. Next one, please. Moving on to our Colorado variant information, the State Public Health Laboratory continues to sequence a sample of specimens from across the state. Right now, we're seeing all of what we're seeing is subvariants of Omicron. BA2.12.1 in the red is the most prevalent subvariant at 52%. BA2 is at 13%, BA4 at 11%, and BA5 at 23%. And these proportions are very similar to what CDC is reporting for the US as a whole. Now I'll turn it over.
Thank you, and good morning, everybody. I'm Dr. Eric Frantz. I serve as the Chief Medical Officer for the Department of Public Health. I'm also a pediatrician over 30 years now as a pediatrician in Colorado. And I can remember back when I started in the late 80s, early 90s, just so thrilled by the vaccines that were coming out at that time to protect children against various bacterial and virus diseases. In, I think, 1995, we had the chickenpox vaccine, which markedly protects children from chickenpox. And over these 30 years, we've seen nothing but these incredible advances through vaccination. And as a pediatrician and a public health doctor, I am thrilled that we now have vaccination available to children under the age of 5 for COVID-19, which is becoming a more serious illness for these young children in the last months. I want to just remind everybody to begin that the work to approve a vaccine, even with emergency use authorization, begins with thousands of children and their families, who we must thank for volunteering their time and effort to participate in these important vaccine trials. As I watch and learn about new vaccines, I'm always paying attention to the very, very skilled, professional, and experienced leaders that participate. And it really begins with the advisory committees for both the FDA and the CDC. These are experts in vaccinology, immunology, primary care, who thoroughly review the science on safety, on immunogenicity, and on efficacy for vaccines. It begins with the FDA, with their advisory council. And of course, they met last week in the early part of June. That leads to the FDA then recommending the vaccine. It then goes to the advisory committee that serves the CDC, that's the ACIP, again with many experts, reviewing the efficacy to determine who should receive the vaccine. The CDC director, of course, then approves the recommendations. And as of today, we now have vaccines for children and infants under five. And I'm happy to say we're busy vaccinating these children today in Colorado. Next slide, please. I think it's important to recognize that something serious happened with the Omicron variant. When this pandemic began in March of 2020, we were all struck by how the virus was causing serious disease for our older populations and seemed to leave the young children free from harm. That really changed with the Omicron variant, which arrived in Denver in December through February and across the nation. And what we found was that with Omicron, hospitalization rates now in the children four and under were actually higher than they were for the 12 to 17 year olds or the 5 to 11 year olds. Hospitalization rates for children with COVID in this age group was actually twice as high as what we had been seeing with chickenpox before we had that vaccine, or for pneumonia diseases, pneumococcal bacteria infections. COVID was having twice as high a rate of hospitalizations for children four and under. And almost one of every four child hospitalized during Omicron was in the ICU. And remember too that COVID Omicron variant has consequences for children. It causes symptoms that can last longer than 4 weeks, fatigue, cough. It causes a very serious but rare condition called multi-system inflammatory syndrome of children, where 70 to 80% of those children are in the ICU. And so we have to think about this disease, COVID, in the time of Omicron as a serious disease. The hospitalization rates that we had in December through February of this last year for Omicron were as high or higher than the hospitalization rates in children of the same age for influenza over the last 5 years, from 2017 through 2022. So comparatively speaking, recognize that COVID hospitalizations for the young children is what you would say occurs for flu in young children. Children in Colorado and across the country have high vaccination rates for flu. 70, 75% of them are getting their flu shots every year so that they aren't hospitalized. And I think it's very important that children under four and under be vaccinated for COVID. Next slide, please. Well, what do we know about this vaccine? Well, we have a lot of experience, of course, for children 5 through 18 with millions of doses given that give us good insight into the safety. These vaccine randomized trials that were just completed that led to this new recommendation showed that this vaccine is safe, that it has the kinds of symptoms that we see with other childhood vaccines, like the chickenpox shot, like the pneumonia shot. Kids have local reactions around the shot site. Kids might have redness and soreness of the arm, fever that might occur on days one or two after vaccination, but resolved by day two or three. So we see the safety profile as being strong. So we feel confident that children will be safe when they receive these vaccines. I want to remind people, too, that parents are allowed to take paid time off of work to get their child vaccinated. So I'm hopeful that the barrier of missing time at work is minimized through this requirement. So as a pediatrician, I'm thrilled that we have this vaccine opportunity. The vaccine is immunogenic. It's safe, it's effective, and I encourage all families with children four and under to get their child vaccinated. With that, I'll turn it over to Heather Roth, our branch chief for immunizations at CDPHE.
Thanks, Dr. France. I am also thrilled that we have two vaccines available for this younger age population, both extremely effective at preventing the most severe outcomes of COVID illness. So the Pfizer vaccine is approved down to the age of 6 months. It can be given to children 6 months through 4 years of age. The Moderna vaccine is a little bit different in terms of upper age limit, but it can be given to children 6 months through 5 years of age. I think the big thing that families need to know is that these are multiple dose vaccine series, very similar to a lot of other routine childhood vaccines given, all the time to children of this age. So the Pfizer vaccine is a 3-dose primary series with at least 3 weeks between the first two doses, and then 8 weeks between the last two doses. The Moderna vaccine is a 2-dose primary series with at least 4 weeks between those two doses. And really encourage families to talk with their child's healthcare provider around the minimum interval between first and second doses. And like COVID vaccines for all other ages, it's going to take 2 weeks following that last primary series dose to build maximum protection. Now is the perfect time for families to get their youngest children vaccinated. We'll give them enough time to build a maximum protection before the fall and before they return to school or childcare after summer. Next slide, please. So we've been doing a lot of work, probably for the last 6 to 7 months, to get to this point in terms of expanding our provider network and making it as easy as possible and as accessible as possible for families to find vaccines for young children across the state. We're really kind of leveraging our traditional partners in terms of pediatricians and family physicians, as well as community health centers and safety net clinics. But we're also able to leverage our mobile vaccine buses and actually come into communities in partnership with communities to offer the vaccine for this youngest age group. There are also pharmacies across the state that will be vaccinating this young age group. And then our department has partnered with Children's Hospital Colorado on recurring clinics. Yesterday was our first day of 3 clinics. We vaccinated, I think, a little over 900 kids, which is fantastic. We'll be running those clinics at 4 Children's Hospital locations across kind of the metro area. So that includes Anschutz, Colorado Springs, the North and the South campus, leveraging our CDPHE state vaccine buses. And those will run through August 8th. Next slide, please. We're also doing a lot in terms of reaching out to parents and guardians through multiple channels. So today we will start a statewide direct text and email campaign to parents of kids under 5, letting them know that vaccine is now available for their youngest aged children, and also providing resources in terms of where they can find a vaccine provider near them. We are also marketing our Champions for Vaccine Equity program. Again, this is a program that is largely staffed by volunteer physicians, volunteer healthcare providers, predominantly providers of color, who go out into communities and have open dialogue sessions with communities, offer parents, caregivers a chance, again, to have their questions answered by a healthcare professional in a setting that feels safe and comfortable to them. We'll also be doing a lot of virtual and in-person educational visits, really kind of leveraging, again, partners and organizations that are already active with parents across the state of Colorado, including early education, Head Start, child care associations. And then we will be doing a statewide communications campaign. And this is exactly what it sounds like, but digital media, traditional media, again, getting out into communities, making sure that parents of kids under 5 have the information, they have the resources, and they're able to access that vaccine and really make the choice to protect their children through vaccination. I think that might be it.
Thank you so much, Heather. And we're going to move on to the media Q&A portion of this morning's press conference. Joining us for this Q&A is Director Scott Bookman, our COVID-19 incident commander as well, and Alicia Cronquist, Dr. France, and Heather Roth are available for questions too. Let's use the raise hand function. You can find that along the bottom of your Zoom console. We'll start with first questions first. If we have time for some follow-ups or second questions, we'll certainly get to those. Please state your name and outlet before asking your question. And if there's anything we can't get to today, please email us at media_info@state.co.us, and we'll get back to you as soon as we can. Let's kick it off with Sarah Flower.
Hi, good morning. Sarah Flower with KSUT Tribal Radio. Thanks for taking our questions here this morning. I want to refer back to that variant slide that you had shown earlier. While it looks like the BA.2.1.2 cases are smaller, the BA4 and BA5 seem to be increasing. Any idea which wave of the Omicron subvariant we're riding right now? Thank you.
We have seen the BA4 and 5 increase across the country, and so we believe that we're right in sync with what's going on across the country. In terms of which wave we're riding, I would say an Omicron wave. And we're monitoring all of that to see which way it goes. It does look like BA.2.12.1, BA.4, and BA.5 are more transmissible. And so we are expecting to see higher proportions of those subvariants.
All right, let's go to Alex Rose.
Good morning, and thanks again for taking our questions. Looking historically at the data here in Colorado, most of the time when we peak with cases, we're peaking in the fall or we're peaking in the wintertime, right? It's interesting to me, at least, seeing that we're peaking in cases this deep into the summer. Usually, you know, June is pretty much when we see a lull. Is that at all concerning to you, Dr. France, or anybody else? And does that really just speak to how transmissible these subvariants of Omicron are? Thank you.
Yeah, I think, thanks for the question. We really are going to see waves depending on the national and international movement of variants across the world, and they will likely be independent of season. It will be what's spreading around, what's becoming the most common virus in our communities. That said, you can imagine here at the State Health Department, we're very focused on October to February 2022 to 2023, because we've had 2 years now, 20 and 21, where our peak cases were during the fall. And so we have to prepare ourselves for the potential of peak cases occurring again this fall. I think I'll feel more confident that we've moved into an endemic stage if the peaks are small this fall and manageable. I'm hopeful that will be our experience, but I don't have the crystal ball to really understand what variant we might have and how impactful it will be late fall, early winter.
Great, let's go to Adari Riera.
Hello, everyone. My name is Adari. I'm with Telemundo. Thank you for answering our questions. My question would be in regards to children vaccinations. My question is, would children need a booster, like children under the age of 5? And if so, when would they most likely be available to access to a booster shot?
Thanks for the question. Regarding boosters for children, at this point, we're really focused on the primary series. That's what's been recommended. And I recommend all children and families speak with their doctors, their physician assistants, their nurses to get their vaccinations done, particularly during the summer, because there's so many well baby checkups this time of year where kids are coming in before school, before daycare to get their vaccines caught up. It's a perfect time to get their COVID shots. We'll wait to hear more from the FDA and the CDC about whether there will be a recommendation for a booster. I imagine that Moderna and other Pfizer will be looking at boosters for everyone that might be better matched with Omicron or other variants, and that those developments of boosters to match the variant in the community will also be recommended to the youngest children once they've become available.
Right, Meg Wingert, you're up.
Hello, this is Meg from the Denver Post. So with two options for younger kids, is there any kind of guidance on how to one is best for your kid, or is it kind of ask your pediatrician what they recommend? Thank you.
I can take this one, and Dr. France can chime in if I miss anything. Ultimately, I don't think there's a bad choice. And I would encourage all parents to take the vaccine that's available to them and not, you know, necessarily wait for a second option. Both Pfizer and Moderna, again, are extremely effective at preventing the most severe outcomes, keeping your kid out of the hospital, keeping your kid alive. And ultimately, I think it can be a conversation between families and providers around what is the best fit, but I don't think there's a wrong option.
All right, John Daly.
Hi, John Daly, CPR News. Thanks for taking our questions as always. I think there's a question for Dr. France. Given the still kind of elevated levels of transmission out there, what's your best advice for folks to stay safe? Obviously, we have a lot of community events going on, including celebrations potentially of a Stanley Cup victory soon. So a lot of people congregating, maybe more than we've seen in a long time. How would you suggest people kind of handle all those kind of situations?
Thanks, John. There are a lot of opportunities for people to gather, and I know there'll be one soon for that Stanley Cup coming to Colorado. I would say that it's still individualized at this point about how you best can protect yourself from COVID. Recognize that these Omicron variants are highly transmissible and they're out there. Your chances of catching it, even having symptomatic disease, if you're vaccinated, is similar to if you're unvaccinated, because the unvaccinated folks have all gotten it before. So we all have similar levels of protection right now. So clearly, if you're in these spaces, think about your own levels of risk. What do I have immune compromised condition? Do I have loved ones at home that I need to protect? Are there reasons I cannot afford to be ill in the coming week, even if it's a mild disease? If that's the case, avoid these areas or wear your masks and stay out of hot, crowded, poorly ventilated rooms. It's really more of that individual decision-making based on what your understanding of your own personal risk is and your own personal life issues.
All right, let's go to Seth Klayman.
Hi, Seth and Gazette, thanks. I know that this is asking a bit of crystal ball peering, so I apologize in advance. What's sort of your thinking on the COVID trends for the next several weeks? Do you think this is going to be a sustained decline? Will the increased prevalence of BAs 4 and 5 change this direction at all? And then after that, kind of heading into the fall, as Dr. France mentioned, what's CDPHE thinking or projecting?
I can take that one. I do wish we had a crystal ball. What I can say is that right now we're seeing a decline in cases, and we've seen that in other states in the Northeast as well. And so we're hoping to follow in their path, and we'll keep monitoring to see what else comes our way. But we are hoping, at least for the next 2 weeks, to see a sustained decline in cases and hopefully hospitalizations following.
Okay, let's go to Rob Dawson.
Hi, Rob Dawson, KOA. Just a question, is there a strain on pediatric hospitals or pediatric offices with the COVID caseload in children ages 0 to 4 right now?
I have not heard that there's any strain in hospitalization caseload at Children's Hospital at this time.
All right, do we have any other first questions? All right, let's go back to Adari for follow-up.
Yes, this would be a quick one. I don't remember if you guys mentioned it, but do we know how many children received the vaccine yesterday? Was the first day that it was available, or an approximate number?
Sure, I actually do have that number. So as of 8 o'clock this morning, 381 doses have been reported to our immunization information system having been given to this younger age population. I imagine the number is actually quite a bit higher than that.
Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you everyone for joining us this morning for this update. If you have any questions that you think of later or that we weren't able to get to today, please email us at media_info@state.co.us and we'll get back to you as soon as we can. Thanks again for joining us and thanks to all of our presenters. Have a great rest of your day.
And thank you folks for tuning into Fox 31 Now. I'm Alex Rose. That wraps up the latest information on COVID-19 here in our state. As always, and we haven't done one of these in quite some time. The press conferences are few and far between after that massive, and you can see it on the screen, that Omicron spike that happened at the beginning of the year. We had a historic lull in terms of cases in our state in March, but then we really ramped up and the cases kind of peaked over back on June 9th, so we're about 2 weeks removed from that peak. And so again, that was part of my question, if you didn't hear it, to the folks over at CDPHE. When you look at June as a whole, it's usually one of our lowest points, June 9th in 2021. We were incredibly low June all the way back, in 2020, we were very low. But then again, we also didn't have widespread testing at that time. So it's kind of hard to see those numbers. But since June 9th, we've been trending down on cases. I'm going to go ahead and just bring up a quick other points of data, just in case you didn't catch the beginning of the screen. Just want to make sure you guys are informed with the latest on this. Positivity rate is another indicator. So these are the amount of tests that are coming back positive. And it was already the highest point that it peaked, again, June 9th, where our cases peaked, 12.73%. And that's on a week average. Coming back positive. So anytime epidemiologists see that number of positivity above 5%, they get a little concerned. We peaked at about 12. We're starting to come back down 11% positivity. And again, our hospital data, and you heard from the folks with CDPHE there, they were really saying that when you're talking about hospital data, they expect that to fall at a slower rate than what we are seeing for cases. It tends to lag behind. That peaked back on June 14th, it looks like. It's still remains to be seen, again, if that is going to just be an unstable plateau or continue to come down. Keeping in mind now, if we go to the patient level, and I haven't had a chance to review this with you folks since we've been doing these streams, there are now really good just breakdowns of who is in the hospital because of COVID or if they just happen to have COVID in the hospital. We call that incidental COVID. That is under the patient level and the admission reason. So if I look at the latest, for COVID, if you combine the presumptive and the actual confirmed, you're talking about roughly 75% of people who are in the hospital. Three out of four of them are in the hospital because of COVID-19 and not incidental. The incidental stuff, really, so that number has been fluctuating, but incidental went as high as 40% back in March because, again, Omicron and everything. But now it's starting to get a little more severe if you look at the breakdown. So happy that CDPHE has that data. You also can look at the CDC's website to see transmissibility, according to the CDC, what the levels look like. Pretty much everywhere in the Denver metro are considered high right now, all the way up to Larimer County. Some of the Western Slope counties, including Mesa County, the lowest level of transmission right now is in the south and southeastern portion of our state, and also in the Gunnison, you know, and those kind of communities. Some of those smaller counties out there near Telluride and the San Juan Mountains. So just a quick overview of the latest on COVID-19 right now here in our state. That's going to do it for me here on Fox 31 Now. I'm Alex Rose. Thank you so much for tuning in, and we'll see you next time.